So how do we strengthen the U.S. Pakistan Military Partnership to better address these challenges? And I think the administration's recent Afghanistan and Pakistan strategy is a step in the right direction. Now, the strategy alone does not guarantee success. Implementation of the strategy benchmarks to major progress and accountability of all political as well as force cooperation with Pakistan partners in all of these areas. Accountability is particularly important given the significant resources the administration has requested from Congress and the very people for efforts in Pakistan. Following 9/11 in Pakistan has received almost $12 billion from our country, including about $6.4 billion from the Department of Defense Coalition Support Fund, reimbursements and $3.3 billion in security measures and assistance. The recent supplemental budget request for fiscal year 2009 also includes $400 million from new Pakistan insurgency capabilities fund. Does the current U.S. approach regarding reimbursements and security assistance for Pakistan make sense? Or does it need to change in order to better achieve its objectives and ensure major return on investment? And do we have the right balance between security assistance and assistance for economic development? As you know, this legislation came into Congress that seeks to increase U.S. Pakistan partnership on security measures by specifically to investing in U.S. assistance for Pakistan and such conflicts. I look forward to your thoughts, your recommendations, and to what your family and your members have accused of having to do this today. And then we have one, you know, and we're going to questions. And as I said before, we'll be getting a person to get this material. Let's go for questions. And with the background, as we said, procedure as we have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Let me join you in welcoming, a belated welcome, we might add, to our distinguished panelists, and knowing some of you personally and all of you professionally and admired your work, we deeply appreciate your effort to be here and your efforts to stay here. We all apologize for the timing of our closing. I understand we really have no control over that. As the chairman correctly noted, Washington, in fact, much of the United States has been, shall we say, buzz over this nation's Pakistan policy. Certainly, the president helped to increase the discussion on this very urgent issue when he introduced his strategy for both Afghanistan and Pakistan just a short time ago. The fundamental element of the plan is its call for expanding our partnership with the Pakistani military to build counterinsurgency capabilities and promoting closer cooperation across the Afghan-Pak border. right after the legislation was enacted in the House, had a bill that I'd introduced before calling for an increased limitation of conditions on U.S. security assistance to Pakistan to include Title 10 reimbursement and building partnership and capacity programs. And some have expressed, I think understandably so, concern that this proposal would unnecessarily constrain the Department of Defense amidst what is already a very fluid and dynamic situation, to say the least, in Pakistan. That was capped off during our recently completed Easter recess when the administration submitted its fiscal year 09 wartime emergency supplemental request, which includes funding to reimburse the Pakistan military for its counterterrorism and counterinsurgency efforts. As I understand, the measure also includes a new authority and funding stream that would build the capacity and capabilities of Pakistani security forces called the, quote, Pakistan Counterinsurgency Capability Fund, or the PCCF. Clearly, there's been a lot of activity, and we appreciate our panelists' efforts here today to help us sort through all of it. Let's just start for a moment briefly with the President's new strategic direction for Pakistan. It would seem to me there's little debate that Pakistan rests in the political region and is a central front of the war on terror. They're an essential partner, but it's a complex nation with its own set of challenges, including internal political uncertainty, an economic crisis, a rugged western border area that provides sanctuary to Al-Qaeda, Taliban, and other extremist groups who are expanding very dramatically in some instances that reach eastward, and an ongoing tension with India, which was reignited following the Mumbai attacks. In this light, in my opinion, the President's strategic direction understandably focus on Pakistan. While I agree that Islamabad must be part of the solution in the region, I disagree with some who have implied that solving Pakistan necessarily solves Afghanistan. Becoming a true partner will require elements within Pakistan to make the strategic choices necessary to sever ties with extremist groups who threaten both their own internal security as well as stability in the Afghan, in Afghanistan and the region as a whole. And the key to accomplishing this aim will depend on our ability to understand and exploit Pakistan's regional concerns, motivations, and interests. To that end, I believe Pakistan requires a strategy that employs goals and requirements which support a long-term, respectful, strategic partnership instead of one that is merely transactional in nature. This is where Congress must play an important role. As I stated earlier, I'm concerned that efforts to limit and condition existing security assistance and building partnership capacity efforts are counterproductive and, in fact, cut against our overall long-term strategic objectives in Pakistan. Moreover, such initiatives send mixed signals to Islamabad. Let me be clear, these programs demand oversight and scrutiny. Still, I believe that intelligent application of funding conditions should complement, not restrain, our strategic interest. And finally, this leads me to the current security environment in Pakistan. Among the opinion that traditional peacetime framework for security assistance, I'm of the opinion that traditional peacetime framework for security assistance is inappropriate and no longer works. The scale, nature, and frequency of violence in Pakistan, whether it be the Red Mosque incident, the assassination of Mirza Bhutto, or the conflict raging against Al-Qaeda and the Taliban on its western border, makes that nation more appropriately comparable to a combat zone, like Iraq and Afghanistan, and like a central European country seeking foreign military finance. That's why, in response to a question from Chairman Skelton during the recent hearing, General Petraeus said, the correct analogy for our training-equipped forces in Pakistan should be what we are currently executing in Iraq. The General further testified, we need an organization similar to our Security Transition Command in Iraq, and I would remind everyone that this is the organization that successfully built the Iraqi security forces. In short, the administration is militarizing foreign assistance to Pakistan very rightfully because the enemy has a vote. Conflict, as the administration strategy concludes, is in Pakistan, too. Our Pakistan partner requires its military capability for counterinsurgency and more. As such, I feel the advocates of using peacetime paradigms to deal with wartime problems simply fail to recognize foreign security challenges Pakistan face, and the scope of tools required to solve these problems. Again, Mr. Chairman, I thank you for oversight. I'm going to get back to balance my time.
Thank you, gentlemen, very much. One apology to our panel. We got in just as quickly as we could after the series of votes. Thank you for your patience. We look forward to your testimony. Without objection, the written testimony may have is not for the record. We remind members here strictly on the 5-minute rule. And in general, we'll start with you. And again, we thank you all for being with us, gentlemen.
Thanks, Chairman Skelton, and Congressman McHugh, and members of the Committee on Armed Services. And thanks very much for the invitation to speak on the future of the U.S. Pakistan Military Partnership. As the Chairman noted, I'm still working for the Defense Department, but the views that I'll offer today will be my own. In addition to my 19 months serving as the overall commander of U.S. and coalition forces in Afghanistan from late 2003 to 2005, I've stayed very engaged on these issues in my current job. I've taken approximately 24 trips to Pakistan over the last 5 or 6 years. And I recently returned from a trip earlier this year to Afghanistan and the southern part of the country and visited several provinces there. And on a personal note, my youngest son just returned from a 12-month combat tour in Afghanistan where he served as an air cavalry scout platoon leader in the 101st Airborne Division. So we're very proud of him. We're grateful to have him home safe. And we pray every day for his fellow young Americans who are still in harm's way. So this is a personal issue for me, as it is for so many of the members I know, and for those that have young ones serving in harm's way. I'd like to summarize some of my written comments today as briefly as I can. First, I note that I believe Pakistan today presents the United States with its greatest global strategic challenge. It's the second largest Islamic country in the world with a population exceeding 160 million people and a nation armed with nuclear weapons. The meltdown of the government and society in Pakistan would rapidly become the preeminent national security threat facing the United States. Events in Pakistan today are spiraling out of control. Our options in reversing this downward trend are limited at best. I would say that the struggle for the very soul of Pakistan has begun, and the state of Pakistan has a very weak hand to play in this conflict. A key role that the United States and our international friends and allies have to play is to help strengthen this hand. Compounding the challenge that Pakistan state is the internally conflicted nature of Pakistan regarding this extremist threat. The Pakistani military and intelligence services are no longer the secular organization that they were 10 or 15 or 20 years ago. In many ways, they have become much more anti-American in their internal dynamics. They have growing sympathies culturally with the insurgents in this fight. Moreover, I think that the security services remain convinced that their prime enemy continues to be India. No experienced senior Pakistani military or political leader truly believes in the depth of their hearts that the U.S. is a long-term partner in this region, much less a long-term partner to Pakistan. The U.S.-India nuclear power agreement cemented this mistrust in Pakistan, and reversing this widely held belief in the country will be very difficult, if not impossible. From this perspective, all decisions in Pakistan now tend to be based upon the idea of what the region will look like the day after the United States leaves. The so-called lack of confidence and trust in a future that includes the U.S. I believe that the senior Pakistani military leadership remain convinced that soon after NATO and the U.S. give up on Afghanistan, that their long-term struggle with India will resume once again, and that they have to maintain capabilities for the next phase of this war. That's a very controversial outlook, but I think it underlies much of the Pakistani decision-making. I believe there are a few realistic positive outcomes that are imaginable for Pakistan over the next several years. But I can outline three possible scenarios. Of course, there are others. One scenario would be a state failure scenario. This is the worst case option, where a combination of accelerated economic decline and terrorist violence fueled by ineffective governance could destroy the economic and political viability of the country. Some movement towards an internal revolution led by the hardline Islamist factions could take place in this setting. Of course, this would be the most dangerous scenario for us given the nature of the military capabilities that Pakistan has today. The second option might be a continued stalemate where the military and intelligence services restore some amount of control over the insurgents and gain more proficiency in counterinsurgency, but there's continued weak political leadership as governance capacity grows, but the same approach to cutting peace deals with the insurgents continues. This is essentially a continuation of what we see today. And a third, perhaps a more optimistic scenario, would be a scenario of gradual improvement where Pakistan achieves some sort of political rapprochement with India, its economy reaches some degree of precarious stability, and the civilian leadership that's still new in power gains a foothold and is supported and buttressed by U.S. and international aid. This, of course, is an outcome that we are seeking and looking for remedies to move towards. Some possible prescriptions to move in this direction. I would argue, first of all, that Pakistan requires its own strategy with the U.S., and it's not simply part of a single so-called AFPAC strategy, that there are distinct differences culturally, politically, economically, socially between the nations of Pakistan and Afghanistan. And Pakistan deserves a full-force, focused strategic approach in U.S. thinking for that nation. The U.S. must assist Pakistan in managing change economically, militarily, perhaps even societally, as it deals with these huge problems that have been brought on by a deadly combination of factors. I think the U.S. has to assess what factors are required to cause policy change in Pakistani decision-making, to abandon this so-called double game, this hedging approach that is expecting a future without the United States, without the international community. This idea that the resumption of the Cold War with India will be the long-term paradigm for the region. I think the key part of that is that the U.S. has to build a vision of a long-term strategic partnership between Pakistan and the United States. One that's not simply based upon fighting terrorists in the tribal areas, but is a parallel to the emerging strategic partnership that many in the region point to between the United States and India. That we have to grow this long-term, confident, mutually respectful strategic partnership between the U.S. and Pakistan in the same way we've begun to do that with our next-door neighbor, India. In regard to Pakistan's relationship to the conflict in Afghanistan, reversing the decline of our fortunes there and achieving success would leverage our ability to influence events in Pakistan. I think the Pakistani approach to Afghanistan, which in some ways is schizophrenic, would be changed if the U.S. demonstrated success there and we move towards a resolution of that conflict on our own terms to meet our policy objectives. And that would give us immense leverage against our mutual adversary and, I think, with the Pakistani government. And finally, continued and expanded resources for the civil government of Pakistan and their security services, conditioned, or perhaps likely conditioned to performance, but also respectful of Pakistani sovereignty, I think, is an essential step. Pakistan as a state is on a trajectory heading towards failure, and the U.S. must prevent this outcome, perhaps in almost all parts. That said, American aid that's not connected to performance by the Pakistani government and military has proved relatively fruitless. Reasonable benchmarks of Pakistani progress and using American aid as a reasonable price for allowing American taxpayers to underwrite the future of Pakistan as a state and as a partner. Pakistan is not fighting for the West. It is a nation fighting for its own survival, and we cannot allow it to fail at this time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kilcullen. Mr. Chairman, I think you had a bit. I've submitted written testimony on the details of the bill that the company currently considering, which includes benchmarks. I want to go through that testimony a bit, unless you want to ask me about facing the problem as we currently are facing in Pakistan, which is, if you like, a diagnosis of the problem, which is going to allow us to then move forward towards a solution. After 9/11, the United States pushed Pakistan to do more in the fighting and on the frontier against the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. And this was largely an enemy-centric approach, which saw the Pakistani army moving into areas where it had never operated on a warfare before and conducted armed activity against tribes and the civilian population in order to fight and deal with a small enemy element. It was an approach that was focused on chasing and killing bad guys. Since that time, 90% of U.S. assistance to Pakistan has been military. Even within the realm of military assistance, about 9.4% of our assistance has gone to the Pakistani military rather than the Pakistani police. So, for example, in 2007, we spent about $730 million on the Pakistani army and $4.9 million on the Pakistani police. I'll come back to that as an issue in a moment. The Pakistani military have taken a highly kinetic and coercive approach in what they've done in the fighting on the frontier. That kinetic approach has alienated local populations and tribal groupings and communities and has empowered local extremists and also foreign extremists. Those extremists in turn have leveraged popular anger and alienation to create a large and diverse movement that you could describe as a coalition of anger in the western part of Pakistan. That movement has now contributed to a pulling back of Pakistani civilian authorities away from large parts of Pakistan's population and territory, and we've seen the spread of violence and instability through most of Pakistan, including its largest cities. In my written testimony, I've given 24 examples over the last 5 years of egregious breakdowns in security and of complicity by certain elements of the security forces with efforts to cede control of Pakistan's people and territory to extremists. What I'm saying here is that the whole approach has been flawed away from the answer. Doing more of the same will not make things better, it will make things worse. We need a fundamental change of approach if we're going to turn the situation around. We need to focus on protecting the population, not on chasing the bad guys, and we need to do a much greater amount to build up civil authorities and the police service rather than the military. Now, I say we, but of course we can't do that. And what we're looking for here is a search for leverage, which is why we're having this discussion about benchmarks. As Bob Connor wrote off the end of the Vietnam War, no amount of know-how and motivation on the part of an outside intervening partner can substitute for lack of motivation on the part of the local government. And that's the situation that we're dealing with now. I support the use of benchmarks and accountability measures to ensure that people that we're assisting are actually doing the job that we've paid them $12 million to do. But I think I support the idea that we need to move well beyond a transactional approach and make a long-term commitment. But I think American taxpayers and legislators are entitled to ask, why should we give more money and keep throwing good money after bad to the same people until we get a firm commitment to actually stop supporting the enemy and start protecting the Pakistani population? I'll see the rest of my time because I'm sure there'll be questions that will come up in relation to
that. Doug, thank you very much. Mr. Nawaz? Please shut the
Chairman Scotton.
If you're going to close your tonight, please.
I'm a member of the Chairman of the Committee. I'm honored to be here to speak about this important issue before the committee today. We at the Atlantic Council recently released to report on Pakistan that offers very detailed suggestions on the aim for that country. The United States and Pakistan have had a rollercoaster coaster relationship, marked with hours of deep friendship and followed by estrangement. The two countries now are partners again in an attempt to roll back the tide of obscurantism and emergency that grips Afghanistan and Pakistan today. Yet, a deep distrust marks this relationship, arising out of the pattern of engagement. And in this distrust is rooted in both perceptions and reality. The United States
States befriended Pakistan most often when it had autocratic rulers and provided the most aid to Pakistan during periods of autocratic rule when Pakistan was seen as an ally of U.S. strategic interests in the region. The intervening periods of civilian rule also were marked by distance and coolness, and a strong perception was created over time in Pakistani minds that the United States did not understand or care for Pakistan's domestic needs or security concerns. Mr. Chairman, Pakistan lives in a tough neighborhood. It is in the shadow of India, a major nuclear power to the east, and powerful neighbors such as China, Iran, and an unstable Afghanistan. Internally, it is wrapped by a rising militancy that is attempting to force its convoluted view of Islam on a largely moderate population. Pakistan has suffered repeated military rule and corrupt civilian governments that often were in the hands of a feudalistic elite or family-run political parties. Today, the United States and Pakistan are at a crossroads. There is an opportunity to forge a new relationship between the people of the two countries and to overturn the historical patterns. Civil society in Pakistan is on the rise and deserves support. The Chief of Army Staff of the Pakistan Army is publicly committed to withdrawing the army from politics. And the new administration in Washington is committed to a strategy to help build Pakistan via a long-term assistance program that will strengthen its defense while improving the economy. If Washington succeeds in these efforts, it will help break the earlier pattern of the U.S.-Pakistan relationship. But, Mr. Chairman, there are challenges to overcome. The U.S. must ensure that its aid is not seen solely in support of its battle in Afghanistan and directed largely towards the border region of Pakistan. This aid must not be seen by the people of Pakistan as short-term and aimed at propping up any single person, party, or group. The U.S. and its allies must attempt to reduce the causes of regional hostility between India and Pakistan. Pakistan needs to ensure that its government prepares viable and practicable plans for using economic aid effectively and efficiently and controls corruption so aid reaches the poorest segments of society. The government of Pakistan also needs to craft a broad consensus in support of a strategy to fight the militants and strengthen the hands of the silent and moderate majority. Pakistan also needs to accelerate the doctrinal shift from conventional military thinking to counterinsurgency and build its capacity to reclaim the areas of militancy. The civilians can then hold and rebuild those areas. In this regard, certain key elements of U.S. aid will be needed. First, there must be a focus on building up police and paramilitary capacity to isolate militants from within the communities. Second, community-based assistance and heavy investment in infrastructure, such as roads and bridges, are needed to help aid reach target communities directly. The current system of aid flows must change so aid money is not soaked up by expensive overheads in Washington, Islamabad, or provincial capitals. Third, the ability of the Pakistan Army to fight a mobile militancy should be enhanced by providing it more heavy lift capability, helicopter gunships, transport, and night vision goggles. Fourth, the IMEC training program for Pakistan's military needs to rise dramatically, and additional training needs to be organized in the country and in the region to expose larger numbers of officers at all ranks to new thinking on counterinsurgency. Finally, I suggest strongly that the current coalition support fund model of reimbursement for Pakistani operations in the border region should be ended. This is a cause of deep resentment in the army and civil society, since it makes the Pakistani army a quote, hired force, unquote, and makes this America's war, not Pakistan's own war. Let both sides agree to the objectives, benchmarks, and indicators of success, and let the U.S. provide aid for those broad objectives without detailed accounting. We need to rebuild trust between these two allies, questioning the investment claims of the opposite effect. Mr. Chairman, I do not believe in blank checks, mutually agreed conditions of aid rather than unilaterally imposed conditions are the best way of engendering trust. We have to make sure ensure that we set targets that help Pakistan achieve its potential while ensuring its security and integrity. Creating a safe neighborhood in South Asia will help towards that end. Mr. Chairman, thank you. I'm prepared to answer your questions.
Thank you very much. Let me ask one question, please. Reference was made to Pakistan. We need to help ensure that it does not become a failed state and that it is a strong party in the fight against those powers that are to play its border action. So,
I think a comprehensive whole of government look at the needs of Pakistan and how the U.S. can assist in meeting some of those needs would be the first step. Primary one, maybe counterintuitively, to begin with, would be ensuring that the economic health of Pakistan remains solid. If there's an implosion of the Pakistani economy, and really a dissolution of the middle class, widespread shortage of electricity, a breakdown of the economic order, I think would upend the country and threaten its potential failure quickly. So I think we have to ensure that Pakistan remains on a solid economic footing first. And then beyond that, to look at along the lines of what some of my colleagues have suggested, how we can improve the security capabilities of the Pakistani military, the frontier corps, the intelligence services, so that the encroachment of the Taliban from remote areas into urban areas does not continue. So I think that would be a few others I would suggest.
Thank you. I think we need to step back from the frontier where we currently conduct a military-focused operation against the bad guys, back to the incident industry and start focusing on police work and civil authority work to secure the parts of Pakistan that still remain under government control, which are shrinking week by week. We need to stop the work and hold that area, which we're currently in danger of losing. And then once we've stabilized, then start expanding back out. What we're doing in the frontier region now, particularly with drone strikes and some of the other kinetic activity that is going on, it has created such outrage that it's led to a huge spike in Punjabi building activity in the project itself and in the western part of Pakistan. The current path that we're on is leading us to loss of Pakistan government control over its own population. So we need to step back, control what we can't control, and then once we stabilize, begin the process of moving forward again.
Knowledge.
Chairman, I believe that the U.S. can help by creating an enabling environment because Pakistan has a strong civil society. It has a middle class of 30 million people with a capital income of $10,000 on a 30% pound penalty basis. And it has the institutions that can bring the country back from the brink. We shouldn't confuse a state of chaos in a federal civilian government with the failure of the state of Pakistan. I believe that the military still is a disciplined and organized institution, but I agree with my colleagues on the panel today that building up civil capacity and building up policing capacity to protect the communities so that when the military does flare areas where it is used, that those areas can be held is very critical.
Thank you, Mr. McKee. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, I mentioned my opening comments about H.R. 1886, which is a bill that has been introduced that, from my perspective, conditions and limits security assistance to Pakistan that I think, from the administration perspective, is unnecessarily limited and certainly contradictory. I think as well that if you look at the kinds of processes that are put into place under that legislation, it tends to further rather than limit the transactional nature of the relationship. That I think most of us could agree is not the proper way. Still, as a number of you commented, the American taxpayer has to do some sort of benchmark, some sort of metric by which to measure where the money is going and how it's being utilized. how can we find a path forward that allows this long-term commitment, not an over-regulated, over-pontificated approach by the U.S. government or part of the Pakistanis that makes it less transitional, but we can still have some sort of accountability. Any suggestions as to how we could perhaps construct those measurements?
I'm not trying to get specifics, but in broad terms, I think we have to be very careful that we don't instill this idea that somehow this is a pay-for-performance partnership, the transaction performance, that we're paying the Pakistanis to do this, therefore they should do it. I think that's probably wrong in terms of the psychological outlook there, and it undercuts any notion of mutual respect between the two nations and the idea of some sort of a long-term partnership beyond what's required out there today. So I do think that some conditionality is appropriate. I would suggest that there would be some value in having more private conditionality and less public conditionality, whether that's done through closed hearings or done through some mechanism between the U.S. government and the Pakistani government that's done behind closed doors as opposed to being an overt, perhaps even legislated in part of any approach to and I think that will simply undercut entirely the idea that this is a respectful partnership between the two nations that have many mutually consented.
Thank you, Doctor.
I actually think that the emphasis on benchmarks that have been done in HRA 86 is not necessarily bad, because I might quite support that. Part of the deal that gives me a little bit of concern is where it essentially pretends that Pakistan is a willing ally against extremism, whereas the fact is that fairly substantial portions of the intelligence service, small elements within the army, and some other elements are actively or passively supporting the enemy. So I don't think it's in any way unreasonable to expect Pakistan to make a commitment to cease supporting the enemy before we did it more of the same money that's resulted in our improvement. In fact, we delayed the situation since 2001. I agree with you that we shouldn't be taking a transactional approach, but I don't think that the solution is to temper any constraints and just keep on adding on money. I think that we need to push for a genuine change of certain elements within Pakistan. I think it's also pretty clear that the Pakistan's civilian democratically elected leaders do not enjoy full control of the United Nations Security Establishment. And that's another reason why I think channeling funding to the military through elected civilian authorities is a positive step, because it strengthens the groups within the Pakistani government structure that support the United States and do have genuine relations with trust. And it limits the power of some of those elements that are, in fact, working against that relationship. So it's a pretty complex picture on the ground, but I think it's relatively straightforward in terms of assistance. If we keep pretending that Pakistan is with the women out of it, we're going to get the right answer. We have to recognize that some parts of the Pakistani state are on our side and others are not.
In my view, it's not a good idea to fight the conditions, as Mike has put into discussion. Indicators of success by defining the end goal, naturally agreed upon those end goals. And in that sense, another what my colleague, Dr. Kilcullen, has said makes sense that you agree on the objectives. And then I basically believe in what's known as results based budgeting, where you give the money to people who decided what the metrics will be, and then you agree upon those metrics, rather than imposing conditions on front. I think it would be much more effective that way and won't create the impression that this is a base of our scheme, as the environment said.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen. Virtue of the previous agreement, we will begin toward the front, Mr. Kilcullen. We will lead off.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank the panel for being here today. There's so many questions that come to mind as we look at this issue.
fit the forces within the intelligence community, whatever, in Pakistan that are working for the enemy. How do we get them, either through the government cracking down or whatever, how can we get that to stop? And whoever feels free to jump in on this.
My judgment's not that there are elements outside the Pakistani intelligence service and military that are working for the enemy. I think there is very strong evidence that the intelligence service especially has maintained contacts with the enemy for various reasons over the last many years, has a relationship with many of these groups, and has significant influence in a band of women who replace them. I think it's done out of what's perceived as national interest. That there's a belief that if the ultimate enemy of the state of Pakistan is India next door, that these groups provide a weapon and a toolbox to use against India. Not today, but for the day after tomorrow, when the front in Afghanistan opens up again, when there's not necessarily an international force there, or to use it as an irregular force in other parts of the country. So I think ultimately that many of these decisions are made for reasons we might suspect are made in what are viewed as the national interest of the people who are making the decision, that they're hedging against a different future than the one that we see.
If we have success in Afghanistan, and I just returned to live there, and I've heard it so many times, that we could do everything perfect in Afghanistan, and that could be all negated by what happens in Pakistan. If we have success in Afghanistan, General, you mentioned something about that could help bolster Pakistan. I could see perhaps it might hurt Pakistan if the Taliban is forced to stay over there and they start looking for success there. Wonder if you could elaborate on that possibility.
It's my belief that if we defeat the Taliban insurgency inside of Afghanistan, if that's an inhospitable place for them, and if the population is dead set against them, if there's economic growth, if the security forces are much more effective, and if we're winning 2 years from now in Afghanistan, that's going to be a very difficult pill to swallow for the Taliban inside of Pakistan. It's going to weaken them considerably. It's going to take away and affect their rear area, if you want to look at Afghanistan as a rear area. So I think that we do have the ability to turn the situation around in Afghanistan. We actually have far more tools at our disposal in Afghanistan because of all the forces we have there, because of our access to the Afghan army and other territory and other security forces there, and the international force. So we have a huge range of things we can do in Afghanistan to turn it around. And I think doing that will put us in a much better position in Pakistan and put the enemy in a much worse position.
Does anybody, do y'all disagree with that?
Just on some data points out of my written testimony about the behavior of certain elements within Pakistani military and intelligence services. In July 2008, the Indian embassy in Kabul was destroyed in a large bomb attack. Afghan intelligence concluded that it was sponsored and supported by the ISI and the Pakistani intelligence service, and carried out by the Al-Qaeda network, which is an organization that has close ties to ISI. In November last year, there was a very large-scale terrorist attack in Mumbai, in India, launched from the Pakistani port of Karachi and carried out by a terrorist organization, LATAN, which was sponsored and set up by the Pakistani intelligence and military service. The only surviving attacker claimed that he had training for more than a year from retired members of Pakistani special forces and the intelligence service. There have been numerous incidents where Pakistani forces on the frontier had fired on our troops as they attempted to prevent the Taliban from withdrawing back into Pakistan. Last year, we lost over 400 major vehicles on a route through Pakistan that is supposedly protected by the Pakistani military. So I agree that we shouldn't be paying for service. If we are paying for service, we're not doing anything for our money anyway. What we should be doing is stepping back and trying to recreate this relationship on a completely different basis, because it's simply not working as it currently stands.
Okay. All right. So there was a relationship between the ISI and the IDT, and this has been written about and spoken about quite often. There doesn't seem to be any evidence linking government of Pakistan has won my index. Without evidence, and then the other one could have been provided to Pakistan by India, where I understand the state of the press. The Jewish Muhammad, the Mashkir of Zambia, have all aligned themselves with the Islamic Taliban of Pakistan, as well as with Al-Qaeda as a kind of franchise arrangement. And in a substantial number of attacks that occurred in 2008 inside Pakistan, through suicide bombings, the targets were the Pakistan military themselves. So, if anything, this kind of a break of the Frankenstein's monster that was created at one time by the ISI, the use against India and Kashmir, is likely to not have time for the American to be thinking about the relationship. The question is how soon that can come to the table.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The gentleman from Louisiana, Mr. Flood, comments. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yes, I have a question for the general. What type of government would Pakistan end up with if there were allies? You mentioned the unstable things. Obviously, we worry about an Islamic theocracy, such as what we have in Iran today. What is your understanding, based on what you see and what you observe, we may end up with if they were to occur?
Well, again, this is a worst-case scenario. I absolutely hope nothing like this transpires, but I think there are some ways for this happening. My guess would be it would look somewhat like what we saw when the Taliban took over Afghanistan, that they would simply seize all the organs of power. Afghanistan is actually two very different nations. They have very different levels of development. They have very different kinds of military. So it's not clear in my mind how that would lay out in Islamabad. Again, just a horrific scenario. But I think that this idea of a popular uprising, some have suggested that it might look something like the Iranian Revolution in 1979, that type of a nationwide uprising could sweep across Pakistan. Again, I don't think that's a high probability outcome, but I think it's possible. And I think the outlook at that at the end of the day would look very much like what the Taliban ruled their mechanisms in Afghanistan. That same philosophy of rule, I think, would be in effect if they were to put up.
Could I just add something? Whatever the political characteristics of that regime, it would be a nuclear armed regime with about 100 ballistic missiles. That's a fact which should be considered, irrespective of its politics.
In the reach of that ballistic missile would be war.
I don't have the technical details, but it covers the bulk of South Asia and Africa, really. So we would have to ask ourselves what India's response would be in that circumstance.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Kilcullen, you mentioned that you feel like it would be better to assist the police or provide aid to police rather than military. Of course, the police vary in terms of the locale as to what level of corruption may exist, what their sentiments might be, Taliban, pro or against. Do you see problems there? To the same kind of problems we have in Africa today where we provide aid and it ends up in the bad guys' hands.
There are a number of different police forces in Pakistan. The principal police service is right at the provincial level, but there is also a Pakistani police service and the Rangers, which are a paramilitary organization, operates in Sindh and the Punjab, and then there's the Fatih Islamabad. So there are a number of different police forces. There has not been the same level of complicity between the police and the militants as there has been in the history of Pakistan between the military and the intelligence services and militants. They have had the problems as well. They said corruption, lack of equipment, lack of evidentiary capability, like forensics, lack of protective liability. They're intimidated, their families are protected. Not unconnected with the fact that we've hardly given any assistance to the police and the judiciary sector in Pakistan. They're one of the weakest elements of the Pakistani security service. But, as a counterinsurgency specialist, I can tell you there has never been a successful counterinsurgency in which there was not a very substantial role for capable police force.
also say that from a policy standpoint, increasing aid to the police would actually have four substantial benefits, which are listed in my written testimony. It would improve the protection rate of Pakistani people, which is one of the big weaknesses we have. It would improve counterinsurgency performance. It would enhance the rule of law. It would also weaken the political power of the army vis-a-vis the civilian leadership. The police are the only element of the Pakistani national security establishment that's more interested in preventing state collapse and extremist takeover than they are in fighting India. So they've got to be a prime candidate for aid assistance. Also, it's much more difficult to turn police assistance against us than it would be to turn military assistance against somebody else. So it's a safer form of assistance than providing high-tech military assistance. I just think that you could double or triple the amount of assistance we're giving the Pakistani police. It is still only 1.5% of what we're giving to the army. So I think there's scope there for doing a lot more without necessarily cutting back on other forms of assistance.
Chair, thanks to John. We now recognize this is the gentleman from Iowa, Mr. Brooks.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to thank the witnesses for being here today. It seemed to put a lot of common threads. The basic one being, I think that we need a change in strategy and how America approaches this part of the world, and in particular, how America approaches Pakistan. And I couldn't agree more. I do want to echo a concern that Mr. Klein had in the last hearing on these issues, where and I don't know if any others feel this way, but to refer to what we have there now as an AFPAC strategy might be somewhat insulting to many in Pakistan. If you want to comment on that, that's fine. But I do want to ask you, General Barno, you mentioned that really what we need, and I think everyone probably agrees on this, based on the panel, is something of a long-term strategic partnership with Pakistan. All of you have been kind of addressing that without perhaps laying out three or four or five aspects to what that strategic partnership ought to be. I'd like to ask each one of you to do that. I know maybe I'm catching you a little unawares. Maybe have all this in your written testimony already, and that's fine if you want to repeat it. But what is that strategic partnership? What should that strategic partnership in your view look like? Taking into account not only our relationship with Pakistan per se, but India and any other countries' interests in that region as well. General, would you like to start?
That's a very good question. I've not got these through all the way, so just perhaps some initial thoughts about it. I think one of the parallel elements that has to be part of this idea of a long-term U.S.-Pakistan strategic partnership is that we have to, without directly getting involved, we have to encourage both Pakistan and India to continue their confidence building to reduce the tensions between those two countries. That the biggest, in my judgment, the biggest factor that undermines any of our goals objectives in Pakistan right now would underline a long-term partnership is their almost fundamental and unalterable belief that India is their permanent enemy. And India is an existential threat to Pakistan. India will always be a force that they have to be fighting against. If we can break that down, if we can help that Cold War to go away, much like our own Cold War, the Soviets went away, then all things from that point are possible. Our changes are possible. It changes the entire paradigm in the region. So I think that's going to be a parallel effort. In terms of the U.S. Pakistan bilateral relationship, I think we've got to have an approach that has an economic independence, and maybe some things we can do with trade there to facilitate the two nations being linked better together in that department. I think exchange of educational opportunities would be very important, and we've got the best university system in the world. It's like India, every country in the world, having more Pakistanis come to that, perhaps eventually more Americans going to Pakistan would be very useful to break down some of those barriers. There's clearly a military dimension. I think we could do much more in terms of international military education and training in Pakistan. Nearly a 10-year period where we had no Pakistanis at all coming to the United States for training. That's that lost generation of Pakistani officers now that are among the most anti-American in the military because they had no exposure to our schools and our war colleges and our service schools here, which is a terrible thing, a terrible mistake. But we have to try and rebuild that. And then I think clearly there's the equipment and doctrine and training correlation on the military side as well. So those should just be some preliminary ideas. But I think all of these help instill some confidence that we're not just interested in Pakistan for the next 3 years.
that's the outlook right now. It's all about killing terrorists and going after the kind of, in their view of our relationship with them. We've got to deepen that far beyond what we're doing.
Right, everyone seems to agree that the whole transactional approach is called that we have to pass. It's not the right way to go about it. I agree with the gentleman. I want to come in on another category of the issue, which is the multilateral security guarantee, other regional security architecture. A number of other regional players have very substantial interests in the stability of Pakistan. China has a very substantial port facility broader in the southern part of the country and plans to open up both South Europe into Western China, which would be extremely important to the future economic development of Western China. They've got a very strong economic and geopolitical interest in a stable Pakistan. In Pakistan. Last year, John Lee and other militants in Pakistan and Kilcullen carrying out what I would call a slow motion genocide or a shooting in the western part of Pakistan with men, women, and children being killed in an incredibly gruesome fashion. If you look to Pakistan, this imagery of this being passed around Pakistan day by day, the Iranians have a strong interest in preventing that kind of Russians are extremely worried about the situation in Pakistan and its possible effect on the former Soviet Central Asian Republics. The EU has millions of Pakistani citizens living inside its borders and has an interest in a stable Pakistan. India and the US obviously have interests. So it's entirely possible that we have a relationship with the Pakistanis where there's no hope we can do. But multilaterally, there's an enormous amount that we can do diplomatically to give the Pakistanis a feeling of security. Stop using support for militancy as sort of an unconventional counterweight to Indian regional influence.
Three thanks, gentlemen. Now recognize the gentleman who's speaking from Colorado.
5 minutes. Thanks, Chairman. Let me make a statement and revolve on your response to it. And just an observation of our current situation, and it seems to be that the United States is. Finds itself at this time stumbling into another lightning war. And when we look back at the policy, it seems that the first phase was great. In Afghanistan, President George Bush gave air advisory and logistical support to the Northern Alliance, who defeated the Taliban on the ground. And then we pushed them aside and superimposed a political process that gave the Afghan people the government that we wanted them to have. And now, fighting for stability for that government that doesn't have a lot of legitimacy outside the problem, that we are, perhaps our policy is destabilizing Pakistan, recruiting the Pakistan government to fight the Taliban, who are not their natural enemies, that they now they are enemies. And we are there now. And we have to do our best to obviously make this policy work. I think executing ourselves is going to be difficult from this. In terms of support for Pakistan, it doesn't seem that there are any initiatives by the United States to be an honest broker on the situation with Kashmir, which is the focus of the Pakistani military. And I certainly like the idea of extending the idea perhaps to police civil elements and the frontier corps that could hopefully contain the spread of militancy from the fighter. And so, could you anybody respond to those observations?
If I may, just to go back to the broad issue of what conditions would help stabilize Pakistan to begin with, prevent it from being destabilized as an unintended consequence of the war in Afghanistan. There are key roles that the region can play as an economic unit. There are plans already on the drawing boards that were discussed in the advanced stages of preparation for linking Central Asia, Afghanistan, and Pakistan and India, and also for linking Iran, Pakistan, and India, the IPI pipeline. We've covered a lot of these possibilities in the practicable measures in the report of the Joint Council. So I definitely refer members
part in those essays that if you create vested economic interests on both sides of the India-Pakistan border, that feed to their advantage to trade and for the traffic of populations across that border, and it would make it impossible for the two countries to go to war. The two countries, according to economics 101, should be each other's major trading partners. The U.S. is a major trading partner of Pakistan and also of India. They don't care much with each other. The United States sanctions against Iran also involves an impediment to the creation of the RPI in Iran, Pakistan, India, pipeline, because Indian multinationals do not want to run afoul of U.S. rules. So there are these other conditions that the United States can quite seriously change in the region, which would allow the region to prosper by itself without the infusion necessarily of large amounts of aid. And I think that's the critical part, because both India and Pakistan have a youthful population, very productive. They'll be very productive for the next 20 to 30 years. And they can take advantage of these opportunities by also lowering tariff barriers to get all imports from these regions. They could help them out themselves.
I would just pick up something in terms of that, in terms of my success in Afghanistan in 2001. I mean, remember the last Taliban stronghold in Afghanistan before it was Canada on the 7th of December 2001. At that time, there were 110 CIA officers and about 400 coalition special forces operating in the south of Afghanistan. But we had 50,000 Afghans fighting on our side against the Taliban. The reason we defeated the Taliban so swiftly in 2001 wasn't the sheer brilliance of our APR or our high general's weaponry or anything like that. It was the fact that we had Afghans on our side. We still have the bulk of the Afghan population on our side. The approval rate for U.S. forces in Afghanistan was 64%, which is about 5% better than President Obama's approval rate here in the United States. So there's a lot of support for our presence in Afghanistan. We don't have anything close to that kind of support in Pakistan, but large parts of the Pakistani population do not like the extremists. I'm opposed to that. We have tribal leaders in SWAT and they're starting raising their own rights to fight the Taliban. We've committed leaders turning against them. When in Pakistan told me that 70% to 90% of people in the SWAT valley are appalled by the Taliban takeover of the area. There's a lot of groundswell against the enemy. If we can successfully deal with a partnership with the Pakistani people, not necessarily the government or the army or the intelligence services that we've been talking about, the Pakistan people, I think that's the key to clearing some of this way. And that, as Mr. Nawaz says, it's not a matter of aid and paternalistic development, it's a matter of equal partnership.
So thanks to General recognizes General Barno for prosecuting this assignment.
Thank you all very much, and I've appreciated your testimony, and I've heard several themes from all of you, one of which is the trade deficit that we have with the country of Pakistan, and also an emphasis on sort of development of the economy, civilian capacity, all of which takes time to address. And my sense is that we're running out of time, that we're trying to change the dynamic on a dime when we really, it will take much longer than that. So I'm really wondering, are there some strong signals we can send that but communicate that message while we go about the long-term process of addressing these very complicated issues to all of you, each of whoever wants to go first.
Well, I do think that there's a recognition within the U.S. administration that there's a tremendous amount of energy being put on thinking through revamping our relationship with Pakistan. Pakistan has recognized that. We have had a mulling spike out there this week, the second time in 2 weeks. We've had senior delegations going through there. It's on the front page of American newspapers. There's a lot of money being looked at, not only here when it comes to legislation, but what the administration is proposing. So I think there's an understanding that this is a time of major focus and change, and that it's moving in a relatively rapid way. We're still only in the edge of the first 100 days of this administration. So there's quite a bit going on. I think we could probably communicate that better through our information strategy inside of Pakistan. And I think we do very badly communicating to the Pakistani people that that might be an area, whether it's somewhere from Washington or doing better in the region, we would see some success because we're doing that, I think, quite poorly right now. We could better convey what our real goals are and how much interest we
al-Qaeda leadership. Since 2006, we've killed 14 senior al-Qaeda leaders using drone strikes. In the same time period, we've killed 700 Pakistani civilians in the same area. The drone strikes are highly unpopular. They are deeply aggravating to the population. And they've given rise to a feeling of anger that coalesces the population around the extremists and leads to spikes of extremism well outside the parts of the country where we are mounting those attacks. Inside the fire itself, some people like the attacks because they do actually target the bad guys, but in the rest of the country, there's immense anger about them, and there's anger about them in the military and the intelligence service. I realize it might seem counterintuitive, but we need to take our foot off the neck of these people so they feel that there's a degree of trust. Saying we want to build a permanent relationship of friendship with them, whilst continuing to bug the population from the enemy, even if you deal with robot problems, is something that basically keeps them away.
I would suggest something that can be done rapidly and visibly. There is heavy investment in infrastructure. Starting off with Fatah, where if you, the United States was fought first the Pakistan Army Engineer, the Taliban, as well as the Effective Works Organization, building roads and bridges and small dams and erecting tube roads to get the economy going and integrated into the rest of Pakistan. It would be seen visibly as something useful for the local population. And you see a spontaneous growth of the informal sector of the economy around those areas. And in economics, the most immediate and maximum returns are conveyances and in terms of rates of return. The U.S. could also consider helping with some of the major infrastructure projects, similar to what China has done in Pakistan. And that would show that it is there to stay, that it's building for the long run. And one idea is to look at the right bank of the Indus, a highway that could connect the rather all the way up to the north of the country, and then through Afghanistan, the northern rail link to Central Asia. These are the kinds of very long-term investments that could yield some immediate employment as well as a clear signal that the U.S. was there to stay.
Thank you.
Chair, thanks, General. Now recognize the Honorable from California, Mr. Kilcullen, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for being here. Could you go into a little bit? Dr. Kilcullen mentioned it over and over. Why don't we copy the success we had in, I understand, in Iraq and Pakistan and Afghanistan and COVID different places. Why don't we copy the success we had in the Sunni Triangle with the Marine Corps, working at the tribal level in both Afghanistan and I understand, too, all the different things we're talking about Pakistan. They have to allow us to do that. If we want to do certain things in Pakistan, the one thing that they have to let us do it, because we haven't invaded Pakistan, obviously, and we can't do what we want to do. So they have to allow all of these different things that you're talking about. In a perfect world, they would have to allow us to do all those things. So how do we get down to that tribal success that we had in Iraq? Because Afghanistan and Pakistan are very tribal. There's certain areas coming out from other places, and they are very family and tribally oriented there. So how do we really bypass that top level and start pushing from the ground up as opposed to the top down and copy the success that the Marine Corps has in the Sunni Triangle?
I might pick that up actually. Pakistan and Iraq and Afghanistan, as you said, are very different. We don't have the leaders in Pakistan that we have in Iraq or that we have in Afghanistan. But I think the history of the Pakistan and its relationships with the tribes is instructive. The Pakistan army first went into the tribal leaders during the Chiyo Valley campaign in 2002. That was the first time the regular Pakistani military had ever operated on a war footing inside the Fatah. The reason they hadn't been there before was because there was basically an agreement that had been in place since the British period, whereby the tribes essentially agreed to sit down quietly under political agents of the Maliks, the Frontier Corps, and the other elements of the Frontier Crimes Regulation, and provided they were quiet, that would be left to self to govern their own affairs. And once that sanction was, if you step out of line, the army would come in and kick your ass. In 2002, the military went into the Chiyo Valley and lost. And so they called their own luck, and the tribes lost respect for the army. The army then negotiated the Shanghai Agreement in 2004, where Nick Mohammed, who was then the leader of the Taliban, was Pakistan in general, tribes from the soil that are extremists being empowered, traditional tribal leaders being sovereign, and the army looking powerless. So the basic system of how the country was governed has broken down.
I appreciate the history of it, and you know a lot more about it than I do. You also say that in SWAT, for instance, 90% of the people there don't like Taliban. I'm not talking about the Pakistan army coming in and trying to assert authority with each tribe. I'm talking about us helping them or them allowing us to work with them at a tribal level where we go in and empower the actual people to want to get the Taliban and Al Qaeda out of their area. And we can understand that we'll protect them if they do it.
Last year, we started to see the Pakistan army and saw a lot of success in the campaigns in the non-county budget when they started to actually work with the tribes instead of against them. So we know the Pakistan military or some elements of it is capable of that. I don't think that we have the leverage to directly engage with the tribes in this time. And the environment is probably too dangerous for Western NGOs and the civil authorities to operate in there. I think we're going to have to work on the ability of Pakistani civil servants and political agents the Pakistani civil servants and their local law enforcement doing a sort of semi-tribal violent approach.
But let me ask you this, all of these things, that included, requires the Pakistanis to do what we'd like them to do. So how do you make that happen? So those are the whole crux of all of this. All these are great ideas, but how do you make them do it? I don't understand how you make them do what we want them to do without doing pay for play, right, which you simply don't want to do. There's no way to make them do anything.
I think we have to convince them that this is in their best interest and this is the only way to solve the encroaching threat of the Taliban seizing control of even larger parts of the country. There's never going to be American Marines in the Swat Valley and American soldiers in the Swat Valley to do what we're going to do. The reason, in large measure, how that worked is that the tribes finally believed that the Americans were staying. The Americans rightfully convinced the tribe. I had an American brigade commander tell me that the tribes came with us when we changed our message from don't worry, we're leaving, to a message that said don't worry, we're staying. We're not going to be able to get that message in China or anywhere else in Pakistan, I don't think. But the Pakistanis can, and they can do it probably best in some ways to get a frontier corps. I swat a bit outside of that territory, but the rest of the FACA on the Northwest Frontier Province, that could be an approach that the Frontier Corps could take, and the U.S. could very much help advise that, provide information on how to approach that, and help them work with the tribal structures, understand the tribal structures from a bit of a distance. We have some ability to do that today on the Pakistanis resistant to having this present here, but it's never going to be able to think of American forces that can do that thing.
Great, thanks, General. Chair now recognizes the General Warner from California, Ms. Downs.
Thank you all for being here. You were talking about this change in strategy, and I think the message that we have to send. And I'm just wondering, are there some things that you see right now that are not being helpful, that somehow counter this change in approach that we should be thinking about?
Let me jump on that because I disagree with my good friend David here on this. He's mentioned one, which I think would have been the drone attacks. But I have a different perspective on that. I think my judgment is that even though that is disruptive in the minds of many Pakistanis right now, I think that has to continue in some ways because it's the only pressure that the insurgent groups in those denied areas and those tribal areas are feeling. I've seen open source reports that say that there's people living in orchards now because they're afraid to live inside the compounds and they're constantly on the move, and it's having a very significant disruption effect on the terrorist organizations that are there because they're not feeling any pressure from any ground component from inside of Pakistan. And I have heard off the record some Pakistanis say that if that's the only way that we can strike it, that the elements that are out there and have success, then it should continue to be limited. I think there's mixed reporting on that. And from my perspective, I think that there's value in continuing that. I think the public proclamations and the Pakistani government are not terribly helpful for it. So I'd like to throw a preemptive counter in front of the data that we've been posting.
Dr. Kilcullen, could you also comment on, I think, what you talked about, are not understanding the environment. Or at least one of the experts that you spoke to had said that. And do we understand the environment? Clearly, it's a multifaceted environment. I'm just wondering whether we're taking the steps to understand what we're really working with here.
I'd make two points. One on the drone strikes, I agree that they're doing a lot of damage to the Pakistanis. It's us doing that damage. So let me just review. We're paying the Pakistani military to protect our vehicles, which they aren't doing. We're paying them to conduct counterinsurgency. And then the parts are in their own damage. We're going to the end because of our own strikes, which they are then able to say, oh, the bad Americans are striking the Pakistani population. It's not a sound way to do business. There are other ways to disrupt the terrorist movement. Robots from the air. And I would suggest that any tribal culture, like the Persian culture, that to a certain extent looks both cowardly and weak. There are other ways to do it. I'll talk about it in a little bit later. But it's pretty clear that drones are not our only option. Secondly, in terms of understanding the environment, I don't believe that we have listened enough to local people in Pakistan. And I think one of the clearest examples of that is that we have a tendency to look back to how things used to be under the knowledge and try to recreate a structure of sort of paternalist and internal colonialism inside the party. But we've repeatedly pushed back on the idea of elections. And we've said, well, we support the idea that political parties won't be able to operate up on the frontier and that local people are having a vote. I spoke in Qatar with a Durbani religious leader up in the fighting and said, well, why are you supporting this? Anti-democratic stance towards the people of the Fatah, just let us vote for our own leaders. And of course, the counter to that is we say, well, extremists would be elected. And that's maybe true. But if they do a bad job, they will be unelected, as the numbers just said earlier. And also, in the elections that we had in 2008, in that area, it wasn't extremists who were elected, it was the Iranian National Party, which is the second party. So I just think we overstate our ability to influence and we don't listen enough to local people.
Mr. Nawaz, do you want to concur with that or do you have
it? I agree with that. In fact, there was a commitment by the Prime Minister of Pakistan to change the local legal system as well as to integrate the Fatah into the rest of Pakistan. And we're still waiting for action on that. But quite important, I think, is the fact that a lot of the discussions between the United States and Pakistan that are now taking place through the media need to take place behind closed doors. And on the grounds, there is clearly a kabuki theater of sorts going on because there is some kind of tacit understanding. And the people of Pakistan have been brought into it. So it's very important to bring them into the picture. And if one way of continuing the ground attacks because they are successful is by allowing Pakistan sit side by side with the U.S. and take credit for them, the actual kill shots, then it might be the approach. Although I agree with Governor Peter that there are much better ways of doing it on the ground, and you can train people to do that much more effectively without the kind of publicity that ground attacks generate.
Chair, ladies and gentlemen, the chair recognizes the gentleman from South Carolina, Mr. Wilson, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for being here. General Barno, thank you very much for your leadership at Fort Jackson, your success in Iraq and Afghanistan, your son's service in Afghanistan. As we consider Pakistan, I know we all want the best for the people of Pakistan. I had the opportunity to visit and see firsthand in Muzaffarabad the earthquake recovery and relief efforts. The U.S. Marines working with the Pakistani military, I was very, very impressed by the talented military, the very professional conduct that they had. Additionally, very sadly, I had breakfast at the home of Benazir Bhutto, but for the day prior to her murder. And so, again, I'm just so concerned for the country. And General, you've indicated that we need a long-term strategic partnership. How can that best be shown to people of Pakistan that we have a long-term interest in their success?
Well, we touched on a few points that I think earlier, but I think it has to be a
not simply a military relationship, and it can't be a relationship that's focused on the crisis of the moment, which is terrorism within the Tri-Laris Pakistan border rights of Afghanistan. It has to be a serious looking across both governments and how both governments in the United States and Pakistan can find shared interests in the areas of trade, in the area of economics, in the areas of justice, perhaps in border, perhaps in counter-narcotics. There's a huge range of common interests that we could bridge between the two governments of Pakistan and the United States to develop some type of a framework relationship that really projects for the people of Pakistan that we're going to work with them in multi-dimensions, not just the security dimensions, but in multiple dimensions to connect these two nations together over the next 20 or 30 years. And that just simply doesn't exist today. Everything is focused on this one interesting realm. So I think that there'll be a lot of utility in having an enterprise that looks at how we can pull that together into, whether it's a formal agreement or simply, you know, a series of meetings that begins to bridge the two nations together. We think we'd make a lot of money by doing that.
And Mr. Nawaz, I appreciate you pointing out that Pakistan is an advanced country. With 30 million persons of middle class, this is not at all comparable to Afghanistan. In my business there, the people I've been at are just very hopeful. The young students, I mean, it's just a positive experience. I have concluded 4 years in this country, the Indian Caucus. I made it very clear that, as my view, the country that benefits most from a stable Pakistan, and you've alluded to this, is India. And then as I try to work with the people of India, one of the biggest criticisms is they feel like the United States has been a strong ally and support of Pakistan for 60 years. So there's a disconnect there. But how can we promote the relationship between India and Pakistan?
I think the United States obviously now is a friend of India. And for the first time in 6 decades of the life of India, for the first time, we actually have Ambassador Rayburn pronounce India, one of the major allies of the United States, on his last visit. At the same time, the United States is a major ally of Pakistan, and these are not mutually exclusive. So it is very critical for the United States now to use this leverage on both sides of the India-Pakistan border to help them see the possibilities that exist for peace rather than war in that region. In effect, the U.S. has to take the lead now in helping wage peace in the region rather than siding with one country against the other. And in that, the economic relationships between the countries of the region, and not just India and Pakistan, but as I said earlier, in Central Asia and Afghanistan, and the whole region has a network that needs to be established in which U.S. firms can play a huge role, because many of them already have plans on the books for setting up pipelines, for setting up rail links, for railways, and so on. All this can be done to pull these countries together, which would make it impossible for them to make it.
I mean, I appreciate your point, and I would even extend it. I've been to Western Siberia in Novosibirsk, Chelyabinsk. It seemed like to me, and through the stands too, that the whole region of Central Asia should be doing very well economically, socially. So I appreciate your positive view. And however, I can be hopeful. I see great hope throughout the region. So now you have the right to my time.
Jerry, that's South Carolina. We now recognize the gathering for Benjamin, Mr. Department of Finance. Thank you very much. I was here for your very illuminated testimony. Thank you very much. I had to be gone for part of the question and answer period. Maybe it's the scientist in me, but when I'm dealing with options, I'm always more comfortable when I have some probabilities associated with those options. And so if you would humor me and each take a piece of paper and write down the three potential outcomes that the general mentioned, a failed state, a status quo or stalemate for number two, and gradual improvement for number three, so you're not influenced by others' prognostications, if you would write down some percentages that add up to a country. Probability you think it will be a failed state, or probability you think that it will simply continue the status quo or stalemate, or probability you think that there will be gradual improvement.
actually did this before we started because I thought I might get that question. It's a very interesting question. And of course, one that we can't really get a good answer to. Here's the way I would tee it up, Congressman. I said failed state 15%, 15%.
Okay.
Stalemate 60%.
Okay.
And gradual improvement 25%. I really hope those are the number. I didn't do my math check here. So.
I'm afraid I have a slightly different view. I'm taking the assumption that there's no change in U.S. policy and there's no change in the attitude of the Pakistani state. On that assumption, 75% failed state, 0% status quo, things simply cannot go on as they are, 25% to the right. That's on the assumption that we don't change anything.
Thank you.
My book, the failed state would be 15% probability. The stalemate, or what I would call muddling through, would be 55%, and gradual improvement 30%.
Thank you all very much. It's very helpful. I kind of have the feeling that unless we get halfway through number three, there's a fairly low probability of we're going to get halfway through number three if you're that what we are doing in Afghanistan is the ultimate exercise in futility. Even if we are able to do there what no one else has ever done, Alexander the Great failed, the British Empire failed, the Soviet Empire failed, but even if we are able to do what no one else has ever done, it will amount to nothing. Because the bad guys will simply go to Pakistan unless we're at least halfway through number three gradual improvement. Is that not true?
Well, I think there's quite a good chance that we'll be better at Afghanistan because we do have something
the successful, I'm allowed it, we will be completely successful in Afghanistan and do what no one else has ever done. Even so, I don't think we will accomplish anything because our goal is to get rid of the bad guys, and the bad guys will simply go to Pakistan unless we get halfway to number three, and you collectively believe there's a fairly low probability we're going to get halfway through number three.
If you articulate the sole goal as dealing with the bad guys, may not agree with you, but that's not our sole goal in Afghanistan and Pakistan. The fact that we've treated that as our sole goal is one of the problems that we made since 2004.
I would agree with that. I would say that the growth of success in both of those states eventually marginalizes the bad guys. I watched during my time in Afghanistan increasingly for a period of time the Taliban becoming more and more irrelevant to the people of Afghanistan. No one had the interest in being in the Taliban after the Afghan post-election election. The economy was doing better, security was improving significantly. No one had the interest in that outcome, but that's certainly not the case today. So I think if we could set those conditions so that the becoming a terrorist and insurgent is an irrelevant long-term goal for any reasonable Pakistani or Afghan, then we've established some enduring prospects for success.
Congressman, I would choose an analogy from economics. I currently spent 31 years at the International Monetary Fund, and this is called the J-curve hypothesis, which is when things grow worse before they start getting better. And so what may appear to be a 70% probability in David's view, maybe those kind of exogenous shocks that will turn the population and the government and the leadership of Pakistan around into concentrating their efforts so that they can then use the resources of the country, the inherent strengths of their society, and the institutions that exist to pull the country out of the world that it seems to be heading into.
I hope so. That is exactly the outcome. My hopes and my expectations are frequently different in this case. They are different. Thank you very much, Mr. Petraeus.
Chair, thanks, Stuart, for that.
Gentlemen, I very much have found this very enlightening. On the near term, and that which you can imagine, the large number of casualties that the students are planning to see the market, military is contracted with to transport goods to Pakistan, going to Afghanistan. the troops are going to have to die. Safety is that the increased babies have to die with additional troops on their way to Afghanistan. I say all this in the job of the I think it's really good job of telling us sort of things we need to be doing and what you expect to happen. Our question to you, given the immediate escalation of American troops and the need to resupply them, is what is the probability that you bombs during the next 3 years and 9 months that basically the bottom is that like the bottom half of people say that the Pakistani government either empowering two places from the Islamic fundamentalists or because of a change in their attitude themselves. What are the chances of that denying passage through Pakistan of goods down to American troops in Afghanistan? And the next thing, you know, sorry, what's
I think my opinion is that there's a state failure in Pakistan, and that's, that won't happen. Handicap in that was in the 15% range. So, I think as long as you stay in Pakistan, I mean, some say that remains, you know, in essentially alliance with the U.S. And we're mutually supporting each other's goals and objectives, if those lines of communications can stay open their door. As you know, there are also a series of other possible lines in order to distribution that not everyone's aware of. So, at least there's some redundancy in that. But I don't think there's an extraordinarily high risk to the Pakistan supply lines unless there's a major change in the state situation.
I'd just say it depends on what you're actually talking about. But those supply lines were cut and closed 6 times last year already. And
I would talk about the amount of closure.
It's a permanent closure,
yes.
I think that's reasonably low unless the Pakistani state loses control of that main north-south route from Karachi up into Peshawar in the west to the Khyber Pass. It's very, very hard to keep it open permanently, but having it closed permanently, I think, is a reasonably low possibility. But I don't share the positive prognosis of a low chance of state failure. I actually think unless we turn around the policies that we have in place, unless the Pakistani military rapidly gets a lot better at doing this, we are going to see increasing loss of control. So over 3 years and 9 months, that probably drops away.
Mr. I hope that serves properly, Mr.
Yes, it did. I agree that the probability is low. I don't agree that even given the further attacks within the country, the financial challenges faced by the military, the military as an institution would collapse to the extent that it would allow a permanent stoppage to this. However, there is always a possibility of a serious breakdown of relationships between governments in the U.S. and Pakistan. And if that were to occur for whatever reason, then of course we would face this possibility.
Other observation, unfortunately, many of my colleagues have not been able to get clearance to go to Pakistan. I've flown over a number of times when I engaged them. I'm amazed that on the western side of the country, it just strikes me as amazing. It's partially populated. And again, I think what to get to would be traffic from the western part of the country where there were fewer people and therefore fewer people to shoot at you. Would there be any value of trying to work with the Pakistani government to establish such a way? How would that be perceived? Is it necessary?
To clarify, Congressman, you're thinking through the Baluchistan or towards the Iranian border? Well, there's obviously a route up through Karachi, through Spin Bolak that comes out of Kandahar, I think, to come in there. And there's some traffic there, but my understanding is the majority of the traffic does come through the Khyber Pass. So my sense would be that that's an excellent second option to have in the route coming up through south, but that's also an area where the most of the low-grade analysts are saying, I agree, is the
center of gravity of the fight right now, the southern portion of Afghanistan, on the Afghan side of the border. So there's no particularly good answer on this in terms of security for Iraq right now, I don't think.
Is there anything that you've been doing? I'm asking this in the form of a question. Is there anything from Pakistan that government's point of view that would make that beneficial for them?
It's a we've talked about the Port of Guantanamo, which is also featured in a one article in the Atlantic monthly this month. And that is one of the ideas that I had presented, which was to have a very heavy investment in infrastructure development linking Guantanamo to Afghanistan and potentially to Central Asia. That kind of investment would yield immediate benefit in providing employment for people in Balochistan because they have very little chance of employment otherwise. And it would also bring them into safeguarding that because of the benefits of transit fees and other economic benefits arising from a road and a rail link that could link up to the Afghan border, for instance, and perhaps beyond that.
Do you think a significant number of Pakistani individuals would think that is a battle for their country?
If you were to give ownership to the provincial population, yes. If it were done as a central, federally controlled enterprise and contractors brought from outside, then no.
General right now, this is General from New York. Thank you very much, Mr.
McHugh. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I would be very grateful if folks have been extraordinarily patient. And I should preface my comment by saying that most ways I support the administration's resilience plan for Pakistan and Afghanistan. I do think there are some concerns with respect to questions, vacuums that existed that could be filled in less than helpful ways. But nevertheless, I do think that to its credit, the president and his advisors have laid out a plan for, as we've heard in January, these are the only things we can and perhaps should be considered. But nevertheless, I have to ask Mr. Nawaz, this week on National Public Radio, you gave a very interesting interview regarding the administration's recent engagement in Pakistan. I'm going to read your quote, and I just would be very interested in the refinement of these very, doesn't sound so strong words. I quote, "This is probably the worst ever visit by an American team. It was a complete disaster. And if this is how you want to win friends, I just want to find a way to create enemies." That's the end of the quote. Can you help those of us who obviously weren't privy to the details of that visit? What concerns you about what went on?
Yes, sir. To paraphrase, or the words have their words that are out of context. The discussion was about the lead up to the visit. This was a very critical visit following the release of the building in the house as well as the release of the strategy. And so there were tremendous expectations. And I began by saying that the art was in the right place, meaning that the United States was saying and planning and doing a lot of very good things for Pakistan. Unfortunately, the public message that was conveyed before the visit through newspaper articles and leaks created a very serious public backlash within Pakistan. So it ended up overshadowing whichever positive results may have emerged in the closed down meetings. And so the public commentary in Pakistan, as well as private feedback that I received and many others received, was that the U.S. is only focused on destroying the Pakistan army and destroying the ISI. And there's a very powerful message of Pakistan. And it just totally took away from the positive message that was contained in the strategy, as well as the many great attributes of the bill that is now being made by Congress. So it was in that context that the opportunity was missed. I, in fact, compared it to the visit of Prime Minister Nehru, to the United States in the 1950s, which was also preceded by tremendous expectation, and it didn't come through, and the result was many years of estrangement. As a supporter of the U.S. Pakistan friendship, as a supporter of the president's new approach, I feel that somehow that message got lost.
Thank you, sir. Plus, we're allowed to keep panels or recovery on that question. I would feel bad when the final word is deep appreciation to our two distinguished guests, though, both for their endurance, but more importantly, for their perspective and expertise. So thank you, gentlemen, for being here.
Gentlemen, it is the tradition of Chairman Skelton to limit our witnesses to 5 minutes. That was an effort to give everybody the opportunity to ask their questions. Since we are still shy of that 44th item, we said, John, if there's anything that any of you would like to say before the ranking, before we turn them apart, what would you like?
The only thing I would add would be that I think in the dialogue today, it's clear to everyone in this room that this is a very serious problem, perhaps the most serious security problem that the U.S. is facing over the next several years. If things go awry, if any of these perspectives on worst-case scenarios begin to accelerate and become more probable, then there is a great risk that we're going to have an extraordinarily dangerous situation in this part of the world. I think based upon that alone, the amount of attention that the U.S. is giving as a cost right now, it needs to be extraordinarily high. This could become a crisis very quickly. I think that even though we were, I personally have been highly engaged in the Afghanistan side of the aspect, this particular challenge in Pakistan could escalate into an extraordinarily serious crisis in a very short period of time. I think it deserves very, very serious attention. And I'm seeing indications that it's certainly getting there right now.
Thank you, John. Nothing to really add to, but I just want to summarize, I guess, briefly one of my main points. I think we need to develop rapidly a sense of agency. I'm very encouraged by this area, and I think it's a good sign. We need to put somebody in charge of Pakistan policy, one person, and the right staff and authorities to actually come up with a comprehensive plan. I think that seems like an obvious statement, but we haven't yet done that. We need to hold the Pakistani military and intelligence service accountable. And I think benchmarks are part of that, but they've got the full story because you don't want to get into that paper performance approach. We need to dramatically increase support to police and rule of law in Pakistan, including civil authorities. And finally,
I would reiterate the issue of partnership. It's very critical that there be discussions, that if there are differences, that they be resolved privately, and that Pakistan understand that it will receive assistance, but it must be prepared to do its bit to make sure that it has policies and plans that are not only workable, but that it will follow through on, so that there are results that it will achieve for its own purposes and not simply because the U.S. Wants it to, or the U.S. Congress is looking for those results. I think this is part of the critical friendship between the two countries. And in the long run, the more the United States is seen as an ally of the people of Pakistan, and not an ally of any single group or individual, the better it will be for the relationship. Thank you, sir.
Again, I want to thank all of our witnesses. I think Alan did a great job as I think. We appreciate that you traveled some distance to be here. The committee does need to do.